Welcome back to Let's Play Disco Elysium Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. There's a shrunk guy here. He wasn't here before. Let's see if we can talk to him. I'm scum, just a scummy old scum. Authority says, there, working class drunk. You know what this means, right? Case solved? Who's Dick Mullen now? I am. Cracked it. All in a good day's work. Wait, what did I crack exactly? What do you mean, what did I crack? Look at how working class that drunk is. Oh. It's her husband, the missing husband, the one in front of the bookstore. Yes, and you found him. Now go and tell the working class woman, protect and serve, recruit. Logic says, didn't she repeatedly tell you her husband isn't missing, though? Empathy says, but he is missing. You heard her, the worry in her voice. This doesn't add up. I'm only making a fool of myself. Authority says, do marriages make any sense? Does honor? You're not a filthy philosopher. You're an officer of law. It's time to ace this case and not brood over your reputation. We can deal with the perception management later. Why not? Give me champagne. I'm going in. There's no need for champagne when this honor, recruit. Go and tell the working class woman what you found right now. I don't deserve her. I don't deserve anybody. Well, she's right there. She's still searching for a book, her eyes wandering over the colorful grid of soft covers. You were right that I'm a cockatoo, by the way. Excuse me? I went and read up on them, just like you said, and even decided on what kind of cockatoo I am. Wanna know? I don't know. The most talkative one? She's ready to put that question aside. Nope, I'm the bleep uppatoo. The what now? It's the one who always messes everything up. No, you're not. Don't think that way, she says, slowly shaking her head. The wind brings a strand of hair to her rough face. You're just a regular talkative cockatoo, and let's leave it at that, okay? Empathy says she doesn't want you to be the bleep up a two. Protect and serve, madam. I found your husband. She crosses her arms. Damn it, I already told you. My husband isn't missing. But you said you didn't know where he was. And I specifically added that I didn't need to know where he is. Well, I found him nonetheless. I'm Dick Mullen. Very well, then, where is he? She's getting impatient, her hands now picking on a random book cover. There. Point to the working class drunk down near the sea. I guess that's not her husband. Excuse me? She blinks. I don't follow. There's something else hiding in her voice, though, Empathy says. A trace of worry. I found a working-class drunk, and I thought he might be yours. Right, because working-class women come with alcoholic husbands. She glances over your shoulder towards the drunk. You know what? Rhetoric says, remember, about the what. Never, ever say what. Something bad, I guess? I'm sorry. I say stupid things sometimes. I didn't mean to annoy. You were right. I do have an alcoholic husband. Although not that one. Reaction speed says, ha! Blam! Knew it. So is he missing as well? No, he's not. Or maybe he is, I don't know. He's probably in the park, or in Jamrock, or somewhere, drinking with his friends. She looks away. I haven't seen him for... Well, to hell with him. She has completely forgotten about her book, staring blank into the distance instead. Empathy says, there. She's worried now. Kim, is it just me, or do we have a missing persons case here? Kim says, I wouldn't be so sure, he replies, before turning to face the working class woman. Ma'am, just to be completely sure, do you want to report it to the police? Report what? He's just out drinking with his friends. I'm sure the police has better things to do than to chase down local goofballs. Not at all. The RCM is ready to chase down every goofball in town. We care about you. She sighs, but you can detect a slight hint of gratitude and relief from her face. All right, go ahead. Do you have any questions? What does your husband look like? She eyes you from head to toe. Honestly, not that different from you. What do you mean by that? Well, he's slightly chubby. I see. What else? What else? He was wearing a dark brown leather jacket with a bright blue inner lining. The lining is hand-sewn. I made it myself. She sighs, her voice slightly quivering when she adds, "It's his cool jacket. God knows it's too cold to run around in this, but he refuses to change. I even tried throwing it away once, but he just dug it out of the bin. Can you believe it?" She looks back at you, shaking her head. "Well, if the jacket is really that cool, then I can totally understand." "Well, what can you do? I hope that at least that extra lining helps keep him warm at night. I wouldn't like him to catch cold." Empathy says she's thinking about him out in the cold, in some park or on the coast, and it's making her more and more worried. "When did you last see him?" "Yesterday morning. He went to the library." Her eyes become cold with recollection. "He went to retrieve my book, and he promised he'll walk straight back home. Because we talked about this. We talked about not wandering off again." She scoffs. "I don't know what to do. I honestly don't know what to do with his addiction. It just makes me feel weak." Logic says, "Gone for around 36 hours, then? Damn, this is a missing person's case." She turns away from you in an attempt to recover. "I got it. Thanks. So you are going to look for him?" "Yes, I will bring him back home to you." "Thank you." You sense gratitude in her voice. "Please do. Even though I'm sure he will return home by himself, I'm still sure of that." Kim says, "I'm sure he will too. When he does, would you let Precinct 15, Kim Katsuragi, know?" He gives her a slip of paper. The woman takes it. It's a phone number. "I will. Of course, officer. As I said, it's probably nothing." Her voice gets anxious again. "Oh no, I got it. Okay. Fine working class husband. I didn't think anything would come of this, actually. The working class woman you've met in front of the bookstore admitted that her husband is missing. Chances are the guy is drinking somewhere with his buddies. Find him and bring him home, if possible. There was another person over here. Well, he's probably moved by now. Down here? Or is that the same guy that... and he just moved. Yeah, he was at the bottom of the stairs. This is where we found that bag. Maybe they've seen a drunk person besides this guy?
"We're still waiting for a replacement for the bull you sent sinking."
"I just saw the statue of Felipe III near the roundabout."
"Ah, yes, King Felipe III on his steed. A reminder of what Revachol once was."
"Oh, absolutely," Gaston says. He smiles as if reliving a pleasant memory. "At the mercy of a cocaine-snorting tyrant who emptied the treasury so he could sleep on a bed of gold?"
"A superpower, feared and respected, a testament to what this country can be under the leadership of a true king, someone who knows how to rule."
"What was that about cocaine?" "Oh, old Felipe was a big fan of the purple nose candy the nobility loved so much, a cocaine connoisseur of sorts." He chuckles. "His egocentricity is borderline legendary."
"You can't even take responsibility for yourself. How could you fathom the responsibility weighing on the shoulders of a ruler?" he asks, obviously annoyed.
"That's why the Philippian kings used cocaine for clarity of vision to aid in their work. Regnum cocainum, Revachol's finest years." He seems to grow taller, brimming with pride about the past. "Of course," Kim says, the lieutenant marks dryly. "Clarity of vision, awareness." Felipe III was even brought into this world with the help of cocaine. The court medic administered a dose to his mother when she was in labor, and it is well known that with the help of cocaine, only the purest, of course, he was able to connect with higher realms. Inland Empire says higher realms, of course, it'll make sense. Rhetoric says he's just making excuses for the king's habits, isn't he? This is going to be another long discussion. Well, seems like irresponsible behavior for a monarch. Drug users shouldn't even operate heavy machinery, much less rule countries. From what I've seen of the officers of the RCM, he begins looking you over, then stops himself. But I don't want to get into a debate about drug policies. What was that about higher realms? Sounds interesting. And then... yeah. It's really not, Gaston says. He turns to Renee. Please do spare us the cocaine fairy tales. Yes, indeed, Kim says. We are not here to investigate the drug trade of centuries past. How should a true king rule? Decisively, without fear of offending the sensibilities of the frail and weak-minded among his subjects. Sorry, guys. I shall be reading for this time. This is something the insurgents never understood. Seems to me a leader should take care of his people before himself. A nation is only as strong as its leader. That is why it was such madness to try to... Don't get started on that again, Gaston says. What happened, happened. There's some weariness in his voice now. He's heard this rant many times before. The Carabineer doesn't reply, but his entire being communicates unbreakable resolve. Alright, very low. Gaston? I feel 20 years younger.
Officer! The mere sight of Policing Martinez makes me feel safer already. How can I help you?
He feels 30 years older when it rains, something like that. I don't want that guy's sandwich. Alright. Okay, this... we need to talk to somebody who's like a therapist or something. The station's Lazareth. In order to sort out your health issues, you can use his motor carriage to make the call, although you don't feel hopeful. Okay, so maybe not a psychologist, but more of a medical doctor. I'm not familiar with the term Lazareth, other than... oh, hold on. He keeps... there's something he wants to think about. Cuprus Kinema. Droplets of rain fall on the white and blue police livery of the motor carriage. Wait, why am I even thinking about this? Wasn't I supposed to do something important? Something murder-related? There's always something important. Doesn't mean you can't take a moment to admire this piece of machinery. Encyclopedia says, this is a Cuprus Kinema. The Cuprus Motor Corps follow-up to their highly successful workhorse, Cupri... probably Cupri, right? 40. And the answer to the LUM's Racing Breed Fever series. Interfacing says, with its air-cooled, rear-mounted 12-cylinder and compression ignition engine driving the rear wheels through a 4-speed manual gearbox, the Kinema is able to reach 100 kilometers per hour in 13.5 seconds and go... to a top speed of 180 kilometers an hour. Won't it roll over in the first sharp corner? The high center of balance is offset by a large battery bank mounted at the bottom of the cabin, feeding all the auxiliary systems and making the Kinema effectively a mobile power plant. This tech talk is really rubbing me the right way here. Due to quite steep price tag, is very unusual to see one in police livery. pointing to the vehicle. That machine really puts the loco back in locomotion. Very cool. The lieutenant smiles ever so slightly. You want to take a closer look? What's it packing there? Pointing to the engine. 130. Encyclopedia says an advancement of the KR18GU engine of the Cupri 40, to be precise. And I'm going to basically tell him that. Yeah, you know it? The lieutenant seems surprised. Just the basics. Cast iron block, swirl chamber injection, dual change driving overhead camshafts, two valves per cylinder, hydraulic valve lash adjustment. Yes, that's right. He stares at you in surprise. I am very impressed that you know these things. A fine machine, running my hand over the smooth metal surface. Yes, there's gentleness in the lieutenant's voice as his eyes run over the vehicle's contours. An extraordinary machine. Electrochemistry says, it's nice and all, but why so modest? Put some zing in it. Flare it up. Slam it down. Visual calculus says, helium headlights would improve the range and quality of the visual field a lot. Authority says, it's a bit girly right now. Fit it with some proper off-road components. Ever thought about switching to helium headlights? Actually, I have a pair at home. Just haven't got around to fitting them yet. I need to lay some wiring for the ballasts first. If we ever get this case solved, maybe we can do it together? You want to help? He glances at you and smiles. Thank you for the offer. That might be fun. Let's do the case first, though, all right? I did say if we ever get this case solved. Redrick says he liked the idea. Okay, let's move. Opening. Pulling out the radio. Alice, please connect me to Station 41's Lazareth. It will take just a moment, officer. Her voice fades out into the familiar radio static. Nix Gottlieb. You hear a man clearing his throat briskly, then an answer. Gottlieb, what'd you want? Perception, hearing, says he's carelessly chewing on a piece of hard candy. I'm in a bad way, Doc. A real bad way. Oh. The man is unpleasantly surprised. It's you. Yes, it's Firewalker here. Firewalker? Yes, you are. Just don't breathe in the general direction of your fire feet. Actually, wait. Do exactly that. Put yourself out of your misery. Take a deep diaphragmatic breath in and you hear an exaggerated inhale and a long exhale on the other end of the line. Conceptualization says it would be an artistic statement of some kind or another. Encyclopedia says self-immolation has been all the rage in Lomenthang for a while now, especially among university students. It is particularly popular in Kohoi, where such acts get the most press. But why? Young religious people protesting the Sarais government, which they consider to be oppressive. It's also got something to do with the encroaching Occidental influences on the local way of life. You have to not like a lot of things to set yourself on fire. Young people are stupid. Yes, especially young people in young countries. Anyway, answer the man. Cop sets fire to himself. That would be quite an interesting conceptual piece, don't you think? Sounds like more like a newspaper headline that will surprise absolutely no one. Now, do you have any current pressing medical problems? I couldn't reach up and grab a tie from a spinning fan without unbearable pain shooting through my arm. Hard to tell exactly what it was over the phone. Could be a combination of peripheral neuralgia and high blood pressure. Could be that you were having a heart attack. Or actually, he seems to be positively surprised by the idea. It could be both, given your profile. Wait, both? That sounds bad. Yep. No wonder I'm in so much pain. I feel like I've been damaged. Yes. Probably in more ways than one. Empathy says you're detecting very little in the way of empathy from Dr. Gottlieb. So what do I do? Cut down on the drinking, pal. In fact, cut off the drinking. The drugs, too. Anything else? Logic says abstinence could have immediate positive effects on your health. I've lost my memory. All of it. With all the damage you've been dealing yourself with drugs and alcohol, I'm not surprised. Authority says there is no surprise in his voice, only careless superiority. You're not surprised? Okay. Anything else? What else? I'm not a brain doctor. Look on the bright side. You've got a whole new life now. Use it wisely. Drama says, it's hard to say if he doesn't believe you or doesn't care. I think I've had a heart attack. And you survived it. Congratulations. Are you mobile? Yes. Even better. Anything else? I wouldn't worry about that. Officers your age have coronary trouble all the time. Also, death is a natural part of life. Isn't there anything you can do for me? What, you want me to do blood work for you again? Tell you just how bad things really are across the board? You want another rundown of everything collapsing inside your body? Yes, I want the truth. You want the real, honest-to-God truth. Stop drinking, eat magnesium, and vitamin D. Our station is not a retirement home. We don't have the funds to deal with rock stars past their prime. And no, I don't want to hear a political commentary on the topic. In fact, I got work to do. Some idiot has glued his eyeballs shut with eyeballs. Some idiot has glued his eyelids shut with cyanoacrylate. It looks like Mac Torsen. Max says, it's not cryoactylate, it's super glue. Doc. Encyclopedia says, cyanoacrylate is super glue. I guess that's it for now. The phone clicks. Suddenly you hear the already familiar voice. Anything else I can help you with, officer? Please connect me to Sylvie again. Dreading this, but I gotta know. Just a second, officer. Sylvie Malaika on the line for you, officer. Yes, hello. You recognize her voice. Hey, Sylvie, it's the police again. Oh, great. She doesn't sound thrilled. What else do you need, detective? Have you seen my badge? Please, no. Not this again. Everyone saw your cool gun, detective. She sounds beyond exacerbated. Oh, a gun. I chose gun. I showed you my gun. When did it happen? You were trying to impress some people with it. Everyone was eating and... She stops hesitantly, not sure if she should continue. And what? What did I do? You were waving it around in everyone's face, begging them to describe it. You said it calms you. And then you started making suicide jokes. It got pretty graphic. Trauma says, oh, those again? I've been trying to wean you off them. Off of what? You know, when you put your gun, your actual gun, on your temple and pretend to shoot your brains out? Off of that. People don't like that. Rhetoric says, I remember this. You were screaming things like, my brains are all over the walls, painting them red. I won't be seeing it because these are my brains. I can't see without my brains. Very nice visuals there. Empathy says, some poor sod was trying to eat his pudding while you were screaming, spit flying, imitating the mercy shot right next to him. Spat some in his food. I don't think he touched it after. Okay, I don't know what to say. Me neither. But what happened to my gun? No idea. All I know is, next you were waving around money instead, saying things like big bucks cannot lie, and guns can't buy money, but money can always buy guns. It almost looked like you pawned it, but believe me, I did not ask. She sighs. Okay, have you seen my badge? Yes, I know who you are. You're a police officer. The law. Rhetoric says, this exact conversation has happened before. Establishing authority before this young girl seems to have been important to you in the past. Don't go there again. My badge is missing. Have you seen it anywhere? Oh, no, I haven't. Sorry. Composure says, real policemen have uniforms, too, by the way. Where's yours? Kim doesn't have a uniform, and he seems real to me. He's in plain clothes, voluntarily. It's different from not knowing where your uniform is. Esprit de Corps says, there are officers who wear the signature Perseus Black uniforms to the highest ranks in RCM and end up buried in them as well. Others do it more casually. Looks like you're one of them. Have you seen my policeman uniform? Uniform? I never saw you in any uniform. You had your things on. The disco things. Do you know how my paperwork ended up in the trash container behind the whirling? Well, there's an uncomfortable pause. You tried to jam it down the toilet, sir, clogging it completely. After I had unclogged the toilet and retrieved the paperwork, I threw it out in the trash, thinking you didn't need it. I am sorry about that. She doesn't sound like she's actually that sorry. Anything else, detective? I think I've got everything I need, thanks. You hear the call breaking up on the other end of the radio. Okay, I'm done with the radio. Okay. Let's try to establish dominance over these people. Since I put a skill point, we can reattempt.
Looks like the circus left town, but the clowns are still here.
Okay. Establish authority. Success. As you look around this room full of sweaty men, swearing, drinking, spitting out tobacco, does this look familiar? Where have I seen this before? You believe the place was called Precinct 41. It was also filled with, almost exclusively, men sitting on desks, talking crap, and wasting time. I get it, Titus. You guys really are the authority around here. Huh? You must be. You're just like real cops, drinking beer and sitting around with your, in your hand. Titus leans in. You got a problem with beer now? Authority says, not quite there yet. Push on. No, I'm drunk on the job, too. I don't give a crap, just like you guys. Speak for yourself, buddy. He puts the beer down. We've been giving crap for 10 years. Martinez was a dump before he put this outfit together. Eugene says, they don't know, man. They weren't here. He turns to you. We had 3 shootings a week. Kids dead, graffito everywhere. You cops haven't shown up since the 30s. Kim says, congratulations on the graffito removal. He turns to Titus. All I see is you sitting around talking about Monica's boobs while there's a rape victim. So what? What do you want from me? We took care of that jerk. He picks the beer back up. Authority says, don't let him drink that. One more push, quick. Good thing this isn't real time. It's not about who did it. It's about the victim. She needs help. Titus. He looks at her. She stops mid-sentence. That's it. You got him. He's going to give up. But on his terms. You want to help her, cop? Fine. I'm going to let you help her. But you treat her with respect. Breakthrough imminent for Jamais Vu. If you don't, if you question her, harass her. Titus taps his chin with his fist. A freight train of pain, buddy. The lieutenant takes out his notes. What is her name? Classe Amandu. She's the one upstairs. She's staying here at the Whirling in Rags. A real pretty one. Silvery jumpsuit. Blonde. Titus adjusts his cap. That's Amandu with an O-U. Inland Empire says, crap, the girl. The girl upstairs? That can't be her. She knows you drank so hard you forgot you were a cop. Miss Aranye Disco Dancer? Sure, why not? You've probably seen her around. He nods upstairs. Composure. I can only do this. Composure. Classe Amandu. Cool. Try to keep my cool. Probably fail. You inexplicably add cool after the victim's name, with your eyes bulging like some wild beast. Your fingers are fidgeting and sweat starts forming on your brow as Titus looks at you oddly. I don't understand what's so cool here. Kim says nothing. He gives you a sideways glance. We just have a few more questions, then we'll be on our way. Rhetoric says calm, normal. Try to forget this little hiccup. So what was her relationship with the mercenary? Relationship? There was no relationship. He raped her. That's their relationship. Shanky says it was like the karaoke accident all over again, or like some of the other girls he was harassing. Elizabeth says, okay, enough. All of this is irrelevant to your stated investigation. So the rape, when was that? He did it before he killed him. He's not going to do it again. He crushes his half-empty beer can. So what does it matter? Kim says it would help if we established a timeline. All right. 2 weeks, maybe? I don't know. I need another beer. He turns to Glenn. Here you go, boss. A tall blonde throws him a can. Titus cracks it open. So, scratching my head, what is your relationship with her? I know her. He looks around in an uncommon silence. Fills the room. How well do you know her? Kim asks. Well enough, Copper. We partied. She's been here for a few months. He crosses his arms. So she's not from around here? You mean Revachol? Nah. Our Miss Aranye Disco Dancer is an immigrant or a drifter of some sort. Been staying here over the winter. Fat Angus says, don't you give her any more trouble? The fat guy blurts out. She's just had some bad luck, that's all. Shut up, Angie. Glenn slaps his forehead. She doesn't need your help. Titus gives them both a look. They fall silent. Suggestion says, what's with all the silences? It's like these guys don't know how to feel about this. You should keep picking at it. You said you partied. Cool, that's cool, but what did you mean? What'd you think I meant? Was it sex? Yeah, pretty much. So you're saying the two of you were close? No, we just screwed, that's all. He states matter-of-factly, I'm not going to give you any details if that's what you're after. So put your blank away. Suggestion says he really went out of his way to seem comfortable with this topic. That's all you're going to get for now. Drama says he's doing a good job here. A commendable performance of I don't give a crap. So I think I know her. You don't know her. Say nothing. Good boy. Well, thank you. We'll talk to her. He points his beer can at you. Remember what I said. Freight train of pain. Thought complete. Jamais vu derealization. The opposite of deja vu. Not already seen, but never seen. Anything that should be familiar appears strange and new, like some half-forgotten day in your childhood, only now. That's the feeling you've been having, and for who knows how long. You should go and ask Joyce Messier about this. What world are we in? This is the fundamental question. Okay. So I get -1 encyclopedia, +1... experience for every orb clicked. Well, that's good. And all intellect learning caps raised by 1. Okay. So encyclopedia goes down by 1, but the cap for it is raised by 1. And as well as the other intellect things. I have no choice but to accept it, so accept I do. Oh, I can level up too. Encyclopedia is still at 5. Get Savoir Fair up a little bit more. Okay, speak to the assault victim. Go upstairs and knock on the door number 3 to talk to the supposed victim of the hanged man. See what she has to say to you. Looking around for bottles and such. Oh, I need to take a morale. And Kim wants to talk.
Officer, what was that?
What was what? He looked strange when he mentioned the assault victim's name. He looks you in the eye. Do you know that woman? Yes. Is there something I should know before we talk to her? Redrick says, whatever you do, don't say the first thing. Okay. I met her in the hallway after I woke up. Understood. You were not in good shape Monday. I tried to hit on her. Understood. He's stone-faced. Better not to add anything to that. He nods. What else did you do? She knows I didn't remember being a cop. Okay. He nods. That's manageable. Redrick told me not to choose this one, so nothing, let's move on. He nods. We'll be all right, officer. This is nothing. You feel I didn't even need to take that. You feel fortified by his assurance. It's going to be all right. So he just healed another morale. I could have saved that drug. Redrick says, is it, though? Nothing? You're still in for a bumpy ride here. Try not to mess it up. Okay. Try to keep that in mind. No knocking sound. Who is it? A woman's voice answered, muffled by the door. Drama says, tired, controlled. This is the police, Kim says. Can we come in? Come on up. The door is open, she shouts. I'm drying my hair.